So, what are we going to discuss today? We were speaking about material and captures and many other different immediate parts of the game that has to do with forcing ways. We mentioned space part as something that is, well, super duper important, but we never really discussed it too much in detail, right? The center and everything around it. You know, someone was just asking me, well, not so long ago, how do I know on which side of the board I should play? It's a big question. You see a position and you don't really know on which side of the board you should play. I think that the best opening to start and explain that is, has to be the King's Indian. So let's see. It has to be something like the King's Indian. Well, if you're playing quietly, it's perfect. Okay. That's really perfect. So, we have our classical King's Indian. And we all pretty much know where white should play in the King's Indian and where black, right? Okay. Well, where should white be playing in the King's Indian? Queen side. And where should black be playing? The king side. And why is that?
Because that's where their respective pawn breaks are.
Right. And how can we see that? We can see that by simply, the first thing to do is look where our pawn chain is aiming. Look. This is black chain. And it's aiming in this direction. So just by looking at where the pawns are aiming, we will see that black is playing on, or should be playing on the king side. And white should be playing on the queen side. White doesn't have, in that regard, a clear pawn chain. But for example, if many times what happens, f3 is being played to support the center when black playing f5, then white is going to have this pawn chain, starting from g2, f3, e4, d5. So we're going to know very logically, just by those ideas, where we want to play just by looking at the pawn chain. This is first part of where to play, what to play, and it has to do with space, where the pawns and space. Now, if we go back, there are quite enough of positions like that that we can get a decent idea how and where we want to play. We will get back to an example that the pawns are most dominant. Before that, let's just see a few more simple examples. Let's look at the dragon or any other Sicilian in that style. Okay. So let's look at this position. Where should white be playing and where should black be playing and what should be the factor in this position? Any ideas? Which side should white be playing? Which side should black be playing? Why? That's good.
It's got a double avenue. Not only is it choices of the C diagonal, but he can swing over to the opposite side from his queen side, where he's free with his king's bishop. He's got all these options.
But in general, that's correct. White should be playing on the king side. But what should be the clearest reason for that? That's true. Julio?
The bishops are aiming in that direction.
Okay. So the bishops are aiming there. Any other?
Where the opposing kings are.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, and that's basically what the gentleman before said, just that he was looking more at the pieces, but just in the most general look, black king is here, white king is here. Naturally, when the kings are in opposite castles, it's quite an invitation to play aggressive and attack. That's basically, so black will make effort to play on the c-file against one king. Well, many times we see white automatically play this move king b1. Actually, these days it is the most popular move, h4, g4, many other moves have been played in this position. But it's clear that black is going to play against white's king and on this side, and white is aiming all his pieces on the other. Okay, so one more reason or one more factor that will help us know where to play is just seeing where the opponent kings are. And by the way, just simple but general question, why would we start pushing pawn if the opponent king is there? What would be our goal?
Checkmate.
Yeah, but checkmate is like, okay, a little bit before that. Not promote in that situation. In some endgames we would, but in the middle game, why would we push? Yeah, basically, we just want to, I mean, for example, think about it in this way. If we have this position, you give away those two pawns, and you take away those two, the game is over. I mean, most likely, just to understand the magnitude of this, just looking at it super quickly, I think that if white will give up those two pawns, and black will give up those two pawns, and white will also give a knight, I think white is going to be winning. Even if he gives a knight and just exchange those, because the open files are going to completely finish the game. You know, let's do this little...
It's a superb tactical attack, too.
Right.
The G and H pawns linked together are hard to beat. They can attack against critical knight and bishop Vincenzo, which releases the queen after you've advanced the pawns.
For example, this position, I'm certain what we gave, look what we did. We gave two pawns, black gave two pawns, but we gave an extra knight. Let's look. First of all, if white to play. I mean, let's see. Just we will be lazy and see what is the computer evaluation. Okay, plus 10. Okay, that's quite a lot, right? All right. Oops, let's have our new position. Okay, now the next position is a very, very tricky one. And I've seen it played at many high level games. Mainly rapid ones, but many games. D4, D5. Knight F3, Knight F6. Bishop F4, Bishop F5. Everything looks super logical. E3, E6. C4. I was actually looking not recently at a game. At a game played between Kamsky against Yuri Shulman. It was actually played in Foxwoods in 2007. I mean, this is not our topic, but it's just something else that it's nice to touch if we are there. Many players will be afraid of the following continuation. You know what? I'll be quiet. Why don't you tell me what possible continuation some players might be afraid with the white pieces? It's black to play. Yes, Julio.
Maybe white might be afraid of bishop takes the knight on d1.
Rook take.
And then bishop to d4 check.
Perfect. This actually even what was played in the game. Perfect. Now, should white be afraid of that? What would you play with white? King e2, you pretty much have to play, right? Yes, that's how the game went. They, you know, it's probably worth our 2-3 minutes to look at that. Of course, knight d2 is losing because knight e4 and this pin just gonna win the knight. But look at that. It looks so bizarre. It looks so bad. You know, one would look at that and would say, well, white is playing so horribly. But it is very interesting. White lost the ability to castle. And you know why? One of the things that we tell young players, beginners, is, oh, you have to castle and get yourself into safety, which is true. But this concept here, the king is in the center. But does the king look pretty safe there? Why no? It has all the pawns around it. It has pieces around it, many pieces around it. This king has all its army around it. And white will very slowly develop. Kamsky played g3 at some point, got the bishop out, got the queen, and got the rook out slowly. By the way, who has more space in the center? White. Well, white has decent space. He has two central pawns. He's getting out. White is actually, I think, tiny better here. And Kamsky went on to win this game. So it's just worth, just very, very interesting example. Let's say that this move is being played. Queen to b3. What is our threat? Of course, taking this pawn. So black logical moves to play queen b6. This is a structure that we see really a lot. c5. Take. Take. Excellent. Okay. This structure comes from the Slav opening a lot. Let's play. We'll take 5-10 minutes and we'll play this position and we'll go back and forth and until we get a tiny bit idea what is happening here. And first of all, based on our idea, where should white be playing here and what should white's idea be? First question, what should white's idea be in this position? Play on the queen side. How? And what do you want to achieve with pushing the pawn further? b4 and then b5. What do you want to achieve? But you think you playing for an attack on the queen's on the queen side? By the way, I didn't say that it's a wrong plan, but I want to understand why I want to play this way. Yes, but what am I going to achieve? Okay, create a pass pawn is a start. Right. Or something else. Why many times we push pawns this way? Because we, what was?
Well, pushing the pawn to b5 would eliminate our double pawn if I can exchange my a3 pawn for this c6 pawn.
Okay, you will exchange it. But those pawns are not gigantic, they're not so horrible, right? Nothing so terrible with them, they're not under attack. But yet I'm still saying this is by far the best plan for white. No other plan really to play here. But why? What do I want to achieve by that?
Well, then the other b pawn can come up and exchange itself for the
other pawn. So we will have a pass pawn.
Right.
This is one thing. The other one is that if we will play b4, b5 and take, we will give our opponent a weakness. The c pawn is going to be weak. Let's hypothetically just show it. Let's say that black does nothing. Just funny, right? In such position, this pawn is weak. Maybe we could have even played more precise. I could play b4 first. So, if the knight capture, we got huge amount of material over that side. Even bishop b5 might be stronger. Look, speaking about pawn structure here. White has one pawn chain, right? This is all one. Nothing, no no space in between. Black has two. One, there is a space, he has no pawns. And second pawn chain. Our basic chess principles tells us that the more pawn islands, the worse it is, right? Because we would prefer to have one pawn island. Maybe here, by the way, this move might even win some material. So this is White's idea. So here comes my question. How would you play with black to make effort to stop this idea? Okay, bishop take knight and a5? Okay. I'll go back. I'll play rook a1. That is true. Because probably I will play before next move.
Did you check?
No. I just played rook a1. Want to attack this pawn. My idea is to play b4. The pawn will advance. Then I will play b5. Make this weakness, and this pawn is still going to be extremely, extremely weak.
You could play a5 with the black pawn first, and then back it up with the a6 with the knight, and the dual power on the b4.
But yeah, but you will have problem with a. Let's say you play this move.
You back it up. You can't do that yet,
no. Yeah, I'll just move my knight, and next, this is my idea. I'll just move my knight, and then b4 is my idea. So this pawn is weak. So, do you like the idea a5?
No.
Okay, so I want ideas for black.
How about castling queen side, gather your pieces against it all together?
But how are you going to do that?
Move the knight.
Okay.
Bring the king to play with the rooks and everything. Then just block the whole idea.
So you let's say that I take your idea and we're going to castle there. Liz, you want to move the knight to d7?
Yes.
Excellent. Okay. I will play this move, for example. Then what? Queenside castle is a bit problematic because I take this pawn and I'm threatening some evil ideas here. So. You don't really want to give me that. The a7, you mean? This one? The a7 to a6, so?
The
b pawn. Oh, that's a big one. Okay, I was waiting for something like this. To where?
To
five?
Yes.
Okay, b5. Excellent. Yes? I can take it en passant, but I don't really want to do it. You know why? Because black will take the pawn with a check, and then he will take the other pawn, and I gave him a pawn. I don't want to do that. Don't want to give him pawn. I will play, I'll tell you what I'll play. b5. I was waiting for this move, and a5, because this is a great topic, what we're going to do today. So I'm going to play, I don't know what I'm going to play. Yes, I'll play this, and then I'll.
I always one question. When we move the pawn to a space,
yes,
in front of the other pawn, the opposite pawn.
That's the passat that our young player in the audience mentioned. But I don't want to play that because of capturing with a check.
Okay.
I don't have to capture, right? I always want to look at captures, but I don't have to. If they are good, I'll play them. If they are not, so I will go here, let's say. So now what? It is Black's turn, right. So let's play bishop e7. Well, maybe get it to the game somehow and so on. Let's just develop so we can castle. Now I'll play this move. And then I will stare evilly at black player and ask him, what is he going to play here? Basically, how is he going to defend this one?
He's not.
He can play rook c8, but then we take on a7. By the way, there is one reasonably cool, just an idea to see. If a6, well, let's just do something fun for a second. This is not the best move for white. It's not. We will see in a second what's the best move. But let's say that we play, and then long castle, like our gentleman in the back rank suggested. What should I play here?
B5.
Yeah, but rook a6 is not just a pawn. It's resigning because it's huge attack. Yeah, because if take, this is basic checkmate that we see, right? Check. The bishop controls all the escape squares, and it's amazing. So, of course, black will not take, but once the a6 pawn is gone, it's over. But this is not the best move, because this is, for example, a move that black will play. He will move his rook from the a-file. So let's go back one more second. What is the best move for white, or what might be a good move for white here? b5. Some idea like that. Maybe knight here is possible. But if not, b5, yeah, I can see b5 as a reasonable move. I just don't like that I will be forced to capture here. But of course, still, white is just better here. Same reasons, right? We will take and then play b4. And white has one big pawn chain, and then this will be our idea, and this is so weak. This will be, bless you, this will be an excellent plan. So, black has a real problem here. Well, we will see how we can maybe solve it. But the idea is this. We see the pawn structure. We understand white is going to play here. We also understand that white wants to play b4, b5, and then create a weakness, or break the pawn structure, or maybe do both. Maybe create a pass pawn. All those things will be done at some point or another. Actually, but before I'll show you, or we'll speak what is the best way. There were two moves that were played here. A5 and B5 at some point. They are logically, at least against what the first world champion, William Steinitz, was saying. We know that we are not supposed to push pawns when there are opposite castles to push pawns in front of our king? What is the logic of that, not to push pawns when there are opposite castles in front of our king? Let me show you this idea, and then we will go back to this one. Let's say that we play one of the Sicilian opening. So we will look at one of the, let's say, knight off, one of the main variation. I need to take. So this will be possibly one of our easiest way. Okay, just let's just play. Forget about all the moves that are here. I just want to get normal development. Perfect. Okay, we played something, some structure that makes sense, but of course there were better ways to play. So now, what in general white wants to do? We already discussed it, right? We said opposite castles, white wants to somehow make those disappear. If those will disappear, okay, this is immediately checkmate. Right? The black king will be so, so weak and open. So white is pushing the pawns to open the position. And he will play g5. Now, what do you think about this move h6? Black is saying, okay, I will fight for this square, for example. Or even if there was no h4, you know, let me make it even more reasonable. Let's say that this is the position. White play here. Black played castle. And now this move. One more. So black can tell himself, okay, white is threatening g5. I will play h6 and stop it. What do you think about this?
Very good.
Not very good. Why is it not very good? That's exactly the point. Exactly. If you need to go back and you have to ask yourself, when is the first contact if black does nothing? It's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4. We'll take white 4 moves to move his pawns here, and then g6. So white will have to play 1, 2, 3, 4, and then g6 for the pawns to touch one another. When you move forward, it's not that you wasted the move. It's that you made it that white will be able to have the pawns touching one another on g5. White needs 3 moves, g4, h4, and g5. And then white will open the position. And black king is going to be dead, right? We're going to have open files. So I remember that when I studied that, okay, don't push pawns in principle, or make effort to do it as less as possible on the side that your king is if your opponent is attacking you. If the opponent is not attacking, it's a bit different story, but here it's very clear. But this is not really the principle that the first world champion, William Steinitz, world champion many, many, many years ago, from 1866 to 1893, so he was world champion almost 100, the first time almost 150 years ago, and was world champion for actually, I think, 1894. So he was world champion for 28 years, if I'm not mistaken. He said the following. He said, do not push pawns on the side that your opponent is stronger. It's not just the side that your opponent is really attacking, but the side that he has more space, the side that he is stronger. How does this relate to exactly what we have seen? Because this is very interesting. We had this position, and very naturally, we had you suggesting several moves that are being suggested a lot. But here, just the other side. So white wants to play those moves. If we will play a move like a5, we are just creating a weakness much easier to attack. Yeah, it's not opening file, it's not checkmate, but it is just a weakness that is easier for us to attack. If we will play b5, we've created this gigantic weakness out there that we can attack. It's all the same logic. We would prefer much, as much as possible, to delay pushing pawns on the side that our opponent is better. So now let me ask you, well, if someone has any ideas, all in all, how still to play for black make best effort to stop a6? There is one very thematic, very basic maneuver here. It involves two or three moves. Okay, this was suggested before. Before. Aha, but you need something. Because now I play b5. If you're going to take here, I think I might take here on c6, and I'll be reasonably happy, right? Because if you will take, we just exchanged, but look at the pawn structure of black, yuck, yuck. And if you, even if you move back, it's the same story. I'm going to take, and then I'm going to follow with b4, b5. Just ugly. So you need to do it, but you why don't you first play this move? That's exactly what you want to do. But you are correct. Your idea is perfect. You just need to first play this. And black is, well, it's a position. We can discuss it. I mean, I think white's supposed to be better here. I actually had some games with white like this. I like this position a lot. But this is the way black played. So most important thing from this example, in this example, this type of play happens so often when our opponent has space on one side. The one thing that we should be careful is not to allow him easy targets. Right? This is what we said, easy targets. Playing a move like 8-6 would help him open the game quicker. Playing moves like b5 or a5 will create faster targets. Let him work as hard as he can to achieve those targets.
That's a very good theory because it forces him to consume his energy with a lot of preparatory moves, which allows you the freedom to find alternatives.
Exactly, exactly. The simple example that we mentioned before was if white needs 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 moves to break on the king side, in our Sicilian example. When you will play 8-6, you make it so much faster. Basically, you are approaching the opponent, but think about it. If you are, chess is a war, right? We always say, so think about instead of being a master, a grandmaster, whatever, you're a general. If there is going to be a confrontation, and you know that you are much weaker, would you prefer to delay it as much as possible? That's exactly the idea. You would prefer to delay the battle as much as possible until you feel that you are okay, not when you feel that you are weak. That's exactly our logic. So that's why we will not play, not just when our opponent is attacking, but even if he has more space and is more clear targets and clear ideas there. Oh, wait. Before we move on, are there any questions, ideas, thoughts about the positions, chess, life? Anything?
Whose position do you prefer here?
No, white. White is better. Yeah. I mean, first of all, I play this, but white is better here. Actually, at the very, you know? I don't remember. I don't know if I can.
Question.
Shoot.
What is the plan for white?
In this position, one of white's main ideas is to play this maneuver. Because this pawn is extremely, extremely weak. Extremely weak. Let's see if I can find maybe one game that I played in this position. It will be cool, Mr. Julio. I didn't plan to do that, but you were asking me what's a white plan. So that's a game that I played, obviously, on the Internet Chess Club, which is, well, I think where most of the grandmasters and professional players are playing, among many tens of thousands of other people. And this is a game I played. I was obviously white, Indiana Jones, if you didn't know. playing in a very big online tournament that was held on ICC, the Dosser Manes tournament in 2008. This game, I think, was from the semi-final. It was actually best tournament online. Well, I didn't play many, but best online tournament I played. There were like 100 grandmasters and 2,000-3,000 people played, and I made it to the final, only to get a little bit crushed there, which wasn't cool, but still, finishing in front of many, many, many players, including local hero Ikaro. Anyway, I had to say it. So, this is, my opponent is a really, strong player. Somehow I managed to trick him, but no, I cannot play right now. But he's like, I think he was world champion under 20 and just a very decent player. So let's see. Knight f3, d5, d4, c6, bishop f4, knight f6. Sounds familiar, right? Tiny bit. So this is pretty much what we were just discussing for the last 15, 20 minutes. I played first knight c3. Okay, queen b3 may be a bit more precise, but queen b6. Okay. What is, by the way, the purpose of this move? Yeah, so I can, so, because this is important diagonal in some situations. So when knight h5 will be played, I will play bishop h2, right? I will play bishop h2. Okay. h6, c5. Okay, so now, serious, no joke, right? I play this, this, b4. No, black is just lost. I mean, just seriously, like it's no joking. Let's say you play normally. You move your bishop to e7, I play b4, b5, then take, move another one, and all those pieces are so aiming at this direction. The bishop, the bishop. So, my opponent played a6. And now, we know that we still want to play b5, right? Because of this pin. This pawn can never take. So what should black play? Rook c8. That's what he played. Rook c8. And here, this is exactly the reason why I show this game. It's because it's exactly true for Julio's answer. I think that the idea that, okay, the idea I played here, I think is the best, and it also worked out really well. It looks that white did a lot, but black defended at least according to what we said, right? He played a6 and c6, fighting against this break. He moved his rook, so this break is impossible. He did everything the way that he could play. But what now? And this is why it was important to keep this diagonal. Because if black somehow managed to eliminate this bishop, he will have rook c7 to defend the pawn.
The only long-term defense I can for a defensive concept would be bishop e7, bishop to d8.
This is what happened. But you see, I will put my knight here. And when he plays this move, b6, even, okay, let's ignore for a second that I can take immediately. I will move back, and I'll be so happy, because then, by moving this pawn, all those are suddenly just targets. Right. So, that's how the game followed. And now, interesting, how to take.
I think
Why with the pawn? Which open file?
The A file.
The A file, but where is the A file going?
Sooner or later, I'm thinking of bishop taking that pawn. There
are
three pawns for a bishop.
Two to start, right? Mm-hmm. There are some ideas like this. But you know, yeah.
You can move the rook up and over, which would attack a d7 pawn.
How? By taking with the pawn, right? In fact, yes. You know, today I was speaking with someone. Actually, I was speaking with Alex. And it was really interesting because we spoke about Houdini and Carlsen and, you know, and the meaning of life and all those big things. But we started with Carlsen and Houdini. And it was interesting that Alex said that the way that we think, according to him, that, you know, humans speak in concept, open file, you know, weak squares and so on. But the more that you look at computers, how they think, they basically, they have the ability to translate those principles into very concrete moves, very concrete explanations. That's a very big idea. I actually agree with him mostly, because the computers became so strong, they don't need to speak in concept. They can actually prove how this concept works many times. So, what's the point? I took with the pawn, but not because the A file, not because I need to undouble my pawns. There's a very clear purpose for it. White wants to play very simply. We spoke before, I had a class here, about how do we win material? We create threats. I need to create threats. Everyone. Material is not falling from the sky. We create threats. The opponent defends, not defending. One of the threats, if I play well, will be maybe more successful than others. Then we manage to win something. So I need to create a threat. It can be a long-term threat. It can be an immediate threat. Yeah. Okay. This is a big threat. Big threat. It's no joke. This is a big threat. This was a bad move, by the way, that I played. I should have just played this immediately. Because what I overlooked. No, it was just a really bad move. He might get some ideas to break in the center. It's just like, you know, when you can put a piece in the opponent's sixth rank. It's not that easy to say no. And by the way, this was a blitz game, so I think for the entire game we each thought like 2 minutes or 3 minutes, I don't know. Like, are those the time at the end of the game? Yeah, so I don't know. I used 1 minute and 43 seconds, he used 1:46. Okay, so it's not like the most longest game. But bishop d6, just more automatic move than a smart move. I want to put a piece here, it's so great, but really I should have played something like this, I think. Because you play this. Yeah, I played f3. I think it's a cool move. Because I don't want him this square ever. So my pawn controls this square. So, by the way, my pawn controls many of those squares. Right here, 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 here. Well, it was important for me to control this one. But there were many other ways to play. But here he played good. This is what I overlooked when I played bishop d6. He played this. And now, amazing, my beautiful bishop here is getting killed. My very pretty bishop is going to capture it. So I didn't play so cool. I should have, instead of bishop to d6, my bishop should have been here and just keeping like endless pressure on him. Super ugly for him. But here, what to play? Actually, I played here very pretty. This I remember. Bishop d6 was ugly, but at least here played a bit better. I think white has actually one move to play. Mostly one move.
take pawn e5, back up the bishop.
But how to take with the pawn? If I take with the pawn, what happens if he's going to take the bishop?
Retake with the pawn.
With which one? E or C? But then the E pawn will fall, and then the D pawn will fall. If you will take, I will capture the bishop, then capture one of those pawns, and then this one. Yeah, I was thinking about it right now. Maybe e4 is a decent move. I will take. Maybe it can take. Rook take, bishop moves. It's probably a decent idea. It's probably decent. But I was more, and I think many white players will be more in a positional mode here. But e4 is probably a good move. I just don't want to really open this for analysis because we are in a positional class today. But you're right, e4 is important idea. I took with the bishop. And here played a move I was very, very proud. Actually, I think on the next one, attacking the pawn, but like an idiot, right? I should have kept my bishop here, so he will constantly have to suffer on this diagonal. Instead, he took my bishop. But here, actually, I'm very, very proud for the next move I played. Might be a simple one, might not, but it's a very cool move.
F4?
I can play F4, but you know, it's not a bad move. But my problem with F4 is that he will retreat his rook. And despite the fact that I pushed him, I gave up something really big that I don't want so much to give. What did I give up?
Square.
Perfect. I gave this square away. You know, it was world champion Bobby Fischer that said, and that's correct, sometimes we give good squares. But why do we give good squares? To get better ones. It was Fischer that said, to get a square, you have to give a square. Impossible. If you can play a move that doesn't give any squares and get more squares, no, just by the rules, it's impossible. Every piece that you move will have to give up a square. And in this example, yeah, giving it the e4 square, it's a very pretty big square. I don't like.
Then you play knight e2, d4.
Because this knight is not doing much, but here, oh man, this is a dream knight. It's like really defending the pawn, right? I don't want him to take. Ah, this is a dream knight, look. But here, you know, here was a tricky moment. I played this. And here, very good move, I think. What did I play? So far, you've been playing very well. Knight e2 d4 was an excellent idea. What now?
Can we just take the opportunity to move a bishop to d3?
Yeah, and then?
Well, he can't take.
Yeah, he can. Okay, he will play g6. Okay, rook e1, king g7, and then?
Well, there's no time.
I mean, you're developing, you're playing okay, but nothing, that impressive.
Do you maybe have the opportunity to play bishop a6 and knight c6?
Yeah, because, you know, it's kind of tricky. If you ask me in general, what do you think about bishop and knight versus rook? What should be the balance? I would say that, and I think, I hope it's correct, that usually a rook and a pawn rook and a pawn are less than two minor pieces. It depends exactly on the position, but it's less. Like a knight and a bishop use really maybe 6.5. Not 6, but 6.5. So a knight and a bishop would be somewhere between rook and a pawn to rook and two pawns. But if I can get two pawns, it's good. Not only that, but I have some pass pawns here. That's some serious stuff. So first move, I hope I remember okay. I don't want to allow him to play knight d7. I don't want him to play this move. So I think c6 is logical. All right, played. And now, how should one do something in such position? What's your idea with rook c1? I first pushed b4, first. But that's a reasonable idea to help this pawn. It's a very reasonable idea. I think I don't remember this game perfectly, but I think I played something like this at some point. But my idea is basically to create a pass pawn that will win the game. If I have three against one and I'm not going to push them, then what are they for? Decoration? Like, those pawns should be pushed, right? You know, I hope that my buddy commentator, Alex Ermolinski, is not going to watch this video at any moment, but I just feel like I have to imitate him every time that when I see this and I have the best pawn should be pushed. Like, there is, so it's like, no, like, all right. If he's watching it, then probably we won't be speaking for a long time, but all right. My opponent is doing what? Bringing his king, right? Very, very logical. We say in the middle game that our king should be safe, we want a castle. But in the end game, the king is a crucial, crucial piece. Why? Because the king is not the object. He's not the target. Very rarely there are checkmates against the king in endgame. They are. And sometimes people forget about it and say, oh, no, you can never checkmate my king in an endgame. Well, never happens too often. But the king has to be a super active piece in the endgame. So that's logical. Rook c1. That's my idea too. I want to put the rook not on an open file, even more important, because this file is not totally open. There is a pawn, right? For the file to be open, there has to be no pawns. But putting the rook behind a pass pawn. So this is, I think this is just winning on the spot. King here. So now, what is my idea? My opponent can never move the bishop because I will take and promote. He can never move the bishop. He can never move the rook up because I will take. So how am I going to win the game here? How am I going to win the game? He's attacking my rook, maybe.
He can't really take it.
B5. Because if he's going to take, don't mess with Yermo. I'm telling you, like, seriously. He said passed pawn should be pushed. So, but joking, no joking, of course, you know, just for if people see, of course, I'm speaking about Grandmaster Alex Ermolinski, US champion, one of the strongest players in the United States for many, many years in the 90s. I think he was first board in many Olympiads, and or several at least. And of course, we are in a great relationship. And I enjoy doing commentary with him on ICC so, so much. So I allow myself to joke. And I studied a lot from doing with him. And one of them is the pass pawn should be pushed phrase, which is true. Pass pawn should be pushed. And now my opponent wants, if take, to take with the knight. So at least he's temporarily blocking the pawns. But how did we kill him?
E6.
Yeah, b6 is, but you know, b6, if you play b6, I might have check here, take. I will defend the rook. It's not totally clear, probably not totally clear if b6. Rook takes knight. Yeah, he has one defender, I'm going to make a queen. So okay, you know, I'll give the rook for my knight for a second. Yeah, just resign, right? Okay, you know, it was just kind of nice game and so on, but we actually got into this game which wasn't in the horizon, but you know, I wanted to show some other examples, but we will be satisfied with this one. It is exactly the structure that we discussed almost the entire class today. The classical space advantage, black is stopping it, not pushing the pawns too fast because it will create weaknesses. Most of the questions, where should we play, on what side of the board should we play, can be answered. One, easiest, where are the pawn chain, the pawns aiming? Okay, it's easy. If this is where the pawns are aiming, it will be a bit bizarre to start playing here. This is where they are aiming. That's one. Number two, it's going to be the kings. If we have opposite castles, it makes sense that we will at least make effort either by pushing pawns or by getting our pieces directed to where the opponent king is, because it's going to be an aggressive game. And some other positions has to be with, well, whether we have immediate space or pawn breaks, better to say. Even if those pawns were tiny different, still that break, because we have more space, that would be crucial. Kings, direction of the pawns, and side that we have more space. Now, I just want to show, or actually just ask a general question. The side that has less space in this position, would black prefer to exchange many pieces here or not, in principle? He would like. Why? But why, if the queen's off the board, he would like to exchange pieces? That's exactly the word, relative. Exactly. You have less space. So let's say you have 20 squares and 10 pieces. Two squares per piece. You exchange 5, suddenly you have 4 squares per piece. You are improving, and relative was the perfect word. Yeah, you take most of the pieces here, then white, it enjoys more space, right? Because look, white has one pawn on the 5th rank as opposed to black pawn here. White enjoys more space. Exchanging pieces almost always is the idea. That's probably going to be the topic for our next lecture. Exchanging pieces, when, how, who, but next lecture.